So there's a study published this week by the Children's Society, which has told us that 1 in 9 of our children are unhappy with their lives. Our young people are worrying more about school, about friends, about how they look. And the study was carried out by Essex University, importantly, before the COVID pandemic struck. Meanwhile, in Northern Ireland, Queen's University has carried out a report for the Commissioner for Children and Young People, and it has found that children have been severely impacted by COVID restrictions when schools and other crucial services were put on hold. So it's clear that the pandemic has actually added another layer of the worries our children have. This is all concerning and got me thinking about the challenges I faced when I was a teenager and how I coped with them. One of the organisations that I give credit to giving me resilience and confidence and self-esteem was the Guide Association. So brownies and guides. And then I became a young leader and became a girl guider myself. And guides provided that values-based system, a structure with rules for girls from all backgrounds, working together as a team to achieve badges, to have fun whilst learning about life. So the question today really for us is, are we focusing too much on mental health issues for our young people and not enough on well-being and resilience? Paul, I think you have some views on that.
I mean, clearly you want to take mental health seriously, particularly in young people, and you need the structures and the measures in place to be able to address it and treat people. My fear is that what we're doing is classifying every negative human emotion as a mental health disorder. I think that's been the direction of travel in recent years. And what that is doing, I think, is sending a message to kids that actually when you're experiencing a normal negative emotion, be it stress or bereavement or you've had a relationship breakup or something like that, that is part and parcel of life. Yes, you need the support structures around you, and we should give that support to young people. But it's not always necessarily a mental health disorder, but often nowadays it seems to me that it's classified as such. And I think the danger of that is that we breed a generation of young people who are simply ill-equipped going forward, going out into the big wide world, to deal with the challenges and the everyday stresses that inevitably they will face, as we all do. And I think a lot of that can be traced back to kind of inculcating in people, you've got a mental health disorder, when you haven't necessarily got that. And I think the crossover between that and the ease with which now I think GPs prescribe antidepressants for young people, rather than trying to get to the root of the problem. I actually think the human mind is a pretty resilient thing, especially in young people, but it's almost like we're teaching them not to be resilient. So, as I say, I mean, in terms of Arlene's point, which I think is enormously valid, yes, we do need the mechanisms in place to deal with mental health disorders in young people, but we also need to give them the strength and resilience to cope with normal negative everyday emotions.
Well, if I may come in quickly there, Paul, on the point you made about prescriptions for antidepressants. I mean, I had my own experience. I remember I was 19 at the time. My grandma had just been diagnosed with lung cancer. It was a very difficult time for the whole family. And I was struggling. And I went to the doctors and I said, I feel like I'm having all these very dark thoughts and I'm not really sure what to do. And within 2 minutes, I was out of the doctor's office with a prescription for antidepressants. There'd been no talk about other kinds of treatment. There'd been no talk about counselling. There'd been no talk about what the side effects of these tablets would be. And for me, they were horrendous. The side effects were far worse than any positive impact that those antidepressants had. That's changed. I mean, I've sort of alternative treatment since then and have had much better experiences than that one I had at 19. But I think it is a huge issue. And I think the point you made there about normal emotions sometimes being kind of dubbed as mental health conditions is a really important one, but also so difficult because you can't climb into someone else's head and figure out exactly how they're feeling.
Yeah, and it's making people feel like victims. This is what I tend to think, you know, that something like, you know, you're a victim of an illness. None of this is your fault. And because you're a victim, we're going to treat you or do what we have to do. And I just wonder, Arlene, I wonder whether making people feel victims for their mental health or any other problem they may have, I wonder whether that's the most negative approach we could possibly take.
And, you know, I do want to reflect the fact that there has been a huge improvement in recognising that young people need support. Mm-hmm. But what I worry about is that we have moved away from concentrating on resilience and well-being and actually preventing them get to a place where, as Deanna has said, she felt she had to go to her GP. So should we not be looking at more of that end, so the preventative piece, how we help young people in this social media age? You knew I was going to mention it, but it has to be the case. Mm-hmm. You know, people are concerned about how they look. They're concerned about how their friends see them. And so surely there are other ways to deal with that, to really build up young people's resilience and well-being. And I think some of our youth organisations do a tremendous job in relation to that. And I think we could help them to do more.
And I think one of the dangers, as I see it, is it's almost, in some quarters, become a bit of a fashion accessory now. You know, when you get celebrities constantly talking about their own mental health problems. And of course, young people idolise these celebrities, and it's almost a form for some people now to mimic it as that sort of fashion accessory. Whereas, of course, genuine mental health problems, you know, people who are clinically depressed, would probably have a thing or two to say about people, you know, commandeering that condition, well, if you like, when they're not actually suffering from it.
It's not something to be glamorised, but I think exactly. I take a slightly different view on that. I mean, I think for me it was really helpful reading about some others who'd been through similar things, sort of role models. I know one that always sprung to mind was Stephen Fry opening up about his own mental health conditions, which made me feel like I was more normal, which made me feel like I wasn't a weirdo for going through this. And made me feel stronger. So I think it's a bit of a double-edged sword.
I guess it's what we classify as being mental health problems as opposed to the difficulties that everyone goes through in their life anyway. And that's maybe where the debate needs to be.
Yeah.
Everyone's going to have periods of feeling down or feeling up or, you know...
There's clearly a line between a genuine clinical mental health disorder and an everyday negative emotion, which sometimes can be protracted, and people may feel under stress for several days or feel grief for several weeks. And it's about drawing that line in the right place, and I just fear we're not doing that.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Welcome to the GB News YouTube channel. You can watch us live 24 hours a day, catch up on your favourite shows, and join in the conversation in the comments below.
Don't forget to subscribe and you'll never miss any of our exclusive content.